Now let us look at a question on thin cylinders. The question says a cylindrical tank is 2 meter in dia, 2.5 meter long and 12 mm thick. Its ends are flat and are joined by 9 tie bars, each 38 mm in dia, equally spaced. If the tie bars are initially stressed to 50 MPa and the tank filled with water, find the increase in capacity when the pressure is raised to 1.2 MPa and the final stress in the tie bars has also to be found out. So this is the initial condition, this is the final condition. Okay, so you have a cylinder whose ends are flat and the ends are joined with the help of 9 tie bars, and the 9 tie bars are stressed at 50 MPa. So you are stressing the tie bars initially by 50 MPa. So this will produce an initial compressive stress in the cylinder. So that is sigma 1. So sigma 1 is the initial compressive stress that comes into play due to this initial stressing of the tie bars. So this is the cylinder and these are the tie bars. You have 9 of them. I've just shown 2. Okay, just for the sake of drawing a schematic. Right, now what happens is, now I increase the internal pressure to 1.2 MPa. Let us say the initial pressure is atmospheric. So now I have increased it to 1.2 MPa. So due to this, what happens is, you have some additional stress being developed inside. Okay, so due to that, you will have a new stress sigma 1 dash over here, and a new sigma in the tie rods also. So we need to find out this one and this value. Okay, so let's start. Let us say that sigma 1 is the initial compressive stress, right? And if you take the equilibrium of this entire cross section, then if you write down the data, diameter of the tank is 2 meter, which is 2000 mm. Okay, the thickness is 12 mm. So this is the data which is quite important for me to use. Length, we'll see where to use. Okay, so the force due to this stress, which is sigma 1, would be pi into d into t into sigma 1. What would be the force due to this stress in the tie rods? This will be 9 tie rods into cross section area of 1 into diameter of tie rod whole square into 50. Okay, so if you put in the values, you can strike off pi o from here. D is 2000, t is 12, sigma 1 I don't know, then you get 9 upon 4, dt is how much, 38, so write down 38, and the initial stressing is 50. So from this equilibrium equation, I can find out sigma 1. So sigma 1 comes out to be approximately 6.8 MPa. So 6.8 megapascals is the value of initial compressive stress that comes into picture due to this stressing of tie rods. Okay, now we can assume that there is no hoop stress initially because there is no internal pressure. Okay, so what happens is, after the internal pressure is applied, okay, or you can say the pressure increases, there is an increment in the compressive stress and it becomes sigma 1 dash, but now in tensile direction. Sigma also increases, so 50 has now become sigma. I don't know what is the value of sigma. Okay, so let me say that sigma 1 dash, what is sigma 1 dash? Sigma 1 dash is the final longitudinal stress in the cylinder. Okay, longitudinal stress in cylinder. Okay, then you have sigma. What is sigma? Sigma is the final tensile stress. It is the final tensile stress in tie rod. Okay, So these two things are very, very important to us. Okay, so now if I look at this figure and try and get an equilibrium out of that, okay, we'll have to find out the pressure force due to the 1.2 MPa pressure, and that has to equate the force due to these two stresses. Okay, so I'll have the force due to sigma 1 dash would be sigma 1 dash into pi into d into t plus sigma, but I'll have to go 9 first of all because I have 9 tie rods, okay, into 38 square into sigma. That's the total force on the right hand side, and that has to equate the left hand side pressure force, which is equal to 1.2 is the pressure. The total area or the net area would be the area of the flat end of the cylinder minus this much area that is being taken up by the tie rods. So that would be pi by 4 into 2000 square minus 9 times pi by 4 into 38 square. So this is the net area that you will have for the pressure force to act. Okay. So from this I can get a relationship between sigma 1 dash and sigma. And the relationship between sigma 1 dash and sigma will come out to be sigma dash plus 0.135 times sigma. This is equal to 49.8. So that is the expression that we'll have. Okay. Now you can easily find out your hoop stress. Now what would be a hoop stress? Sigma hoop. We know it is P into D upon 2 into T. So what is P? It's 1.2. D is how much? 2000 upon 2 into 12. This will give you a hoop stress of 100 MPa. So now we have found out the hoop stress and we have a relation between sigma 1 dash and sigma. Okay. And sigma 1 has also been calculated. Alright. Now, let's try and get a compatibility equation to get one more equation for sigma 1 dash and sigma, because you cannot find out two variables with one equation. So the compatibility equation says that see, there is an increment in the stress in the cylinder also, the compressive stress has also gone up, the tie rod stress has also gone up. This means that there is an increase in the strain for the cylinder and for the tie rod. Initially also there was some strain happening. There was some strain due to sigma 1, there was some strain due to 50 MPa, but now sigma 1 has become sigma 1 dash and 50 MPa has become sigma. So there is some increment in the strain also. So the strain increment for cylinder and for tie rod has to be equal. Okay. So that would give us the one more equation for sigma 1 dash and sigma. So according to that, the increment in the strain for tie rod, let's find out first of all that. So increment in strain of tie rod, that is equal to sigma upon E. So tie rod had a stress of 50 MPa initially, but now it is sigma. So sigma upon E is the current strain minus the initial value, which is 50 by E. So this is the increment in the strain of the tie rod. Okay. Similarly, I'll have to find out the increment in the strain of the cylinder. Okay, so the stress has gone up to sigma 1 dash and there is a production of hoop stress also. Okay, so this is the stress in the direction of length. Hoop stress will be lateral, isn't it? So this would be sigma 1 dash minus nu into sigma h. That's the hoop stress. This is the current strain, that is after the increment from sigma 1 to sigma 1 dash. Okay, and this would be minus the initial strain was sigma 1 by E, but this is a compressive stress. So you will have minus sigma 1 upon E. So this will be equal. So this quantity is equal to this quantity. Okay. So we will get, let me write down over here. So I can just cancel off E straight away from here. Is it? So this will become sigma minus 50 is equal to sigma 1 dash. I don't know what that is. Okay. Nu is 0.28. It's a given value. And sigma h is 100. So 100 into 0.28 gives me 28. So this is minus 28. And this becomes plus sigma 1. How much is sigma 1? 6.8. So from here, I get a value or an equation between, again, sigma 1 and sigma 1 dash. That would be equal to, that would give me sigma 1 dash plus sigma, this is equal to 28.8. Alright, so this is the answer that you will get. Now, let us say this is equation 1 and this is equation 2. Now, this is a simple case of solving two simultaneous equations. So, that would give you a value of sigma 1 dash as 40.5 MPa. So, you can see that from a compressive stress of almost 7 MPa, after increasing the internal pressure to 1.2 MPa, the stress has gone up to almost 41 MPa. Okay, and the value of sigma, that is the new stress in the tie rod, will be almost 70, which is 69.3 MPa. Okay, so this is the first condition that we have to find out. That is, we need to find out the, what do we have to find? Yeah, the final stress in the tie bar and the final stress in the cylinder also. Now, the second part of the question is to find out the increase in the capacity. Okay, so what is the increase in the capacity? The increase in the capacity is delta V, which is equal to the volumetric strain into the final volume. Oh, sorry, the initial volume, not the final, but the initial volume. Okay, now the thing is, I can easily find out the initial volume. Very easy to find out. Okay, the problem would be to find out the volumetric strain. Now, how do you find out the volumetric strain? The volumetric strain, as we did in the previous video, that is, it is equal to twice the hoop strain and plus you can say twice the hoop strain plus the longitudinal strain. Okay, and this into V will give you the increment in the volume. Now, the thing is, the strain value is also not constant. So, we will have to take the increment in the strain. So, this would be twice into increment in the hoop strain plus the increment in the longitudinal strain. So, this would be, if you find out the increment in the hoop strain, that will be, 2 will be there. So, I am just giving you the values. You can substitute that and find out the final answer. It will be hoop strain. So, it will be sigma h upon E minus nu into, you will have your sigma 1 by E, let's take it sigma 1 dash minus sigma 1 by E. So that is the increment or the change in the hoop strain. Okay, the change in the longitudinal strain would be how much? So you have your final stress in the tie rod at 69.3. The initial stress was 50. So the longitudinal strain increase would be 69.3 minus 50 upon the Young's modulus. So this would be the increment in the longitudinal strain. So you put this value in place of the increment of the hoop strain. You put this value in place of the increment of the longitudinal strain and you multiply that with the initial volume. The initial volume would be pi into d pi by 4 into d square, d is 2000 mm into L, which is 2500 mm. So that would give you an increase in the capacity which is almost equal to 7.32 into 10 to the power 6 mm cube. Okay, so I hope you understood this question. It was quite a lengthy question, but I suppose and I hope that you are able to get the idea as to how to balance out the forces, what all things to look into, and how to get these two equations to solve for these two values of stresses. Okay, so this was the question on thin cylinders. Now let's move on to the next video.